Hello everyone, this is Debolina. I hope you all are doing well, and today I am here to discuss with you all about another topic, that is the plant system. So let's start from the very beginning. In 1665, English botanist Robert Hooke first observed honeycomb-like structure in cork under compound microscope. Those were nothing but empty lumen of dead cells surrounded by the cell wall. Robert Hooke described those structures as cell, and thus he was the first one to coin the term cell. Cells are building blocks of all the living organisms, so it is true for the plant system as well. Now, we all know that there is a huge diversity among the plant shapes, sizes, their growth conditions, and so on. Yet, regardless of various adaptations, the body composition of all the seedling plants is based on a common architectural plan. The body is composed of mainly three organs: the root, the stem, and the leaf. The leaf remains attached to the stem at a region which is called node, and the space between two consecutive nodes is called internode. The primary function of a root is anchorage and absorption of water and minerals. That of a stem is to provide support, and the primary function of a leaf is photosynthesis. Plant growth is often concentrated in a localized region of cell division. These regions are often referred to as meristem. The most active meristem in a young plant is the apical meristem, which is present at the shoot apex or at the tip of the shoot, the root apex, and also at the axillary or lateral bud, which is also a growth point for the branch shoots. Now you can categorize all the seeding plants in two different groups, the gymnosperms and the angiosperms. The word gymnosperm comes from the Greek for naked seeds, implying these are the non-flowering plants, for example, pine, redwood, etc. The term angiosperm comes from the Greek for vessel seeds, which means that these are the flowering plants. Plants are multicellular organelles composed of millions of cells with specialized functions. But all these cells have a common eukaryotic organization. For example, they contain a nucleus with typical porous nuclear membrane, nucleolus, nucleoplasm, and the genetic material. It also contains cytoplasm with different membrane-bound subcellular organelles like the endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi body, mitochondria, ribosomes, and so on. The additional key features that make a plant cell different from the most of the other animal cell is the presence of the chloroplast. Also, plant cell contains a large vacuole and a notable cellulosic cell wall. The cell wall is an extracellular matrix which in case of plant cell can be divided into different layers. The first one is the middle lamella. Highlighted here in the yellow color, you can also visualize it in this more detailed structure. The middle lamella is composed of magnesium and calcium pectate, and this is the layer which is first deposited during the cell division. Middle lamella is a glue-like structure that adheres the two adjacent plant cells. Next comes the primary cell wall, which is present at the inner side of the middle lamella. Thus, middle lamella is present between the primary cell walls of two adjacent plant cells. The primary cell wall is a thin, flexible, and expandable structure and is present in the growing plant cells. It is mainly composed of cellulose microfibrils along with hemicellulose, pectin, and different soluble proteins. Next come the secondary cell wall, which is often deposited between the primary cell wall, here indicated in the black color, and the plasma membrane. The secondary cell wall is present in the cells which have stopped their growth. The secondary cell wall is also composed of cellulose microfibrils, which are arranged in a more ordered manner, and they contain lignin, which replaces the pectin in the secondary cell wall. As a whole, the cell wall is important to maintain the cellular integrity. They also act as a pressure vessel to stop the overexpansion of the cell when water enters the plant cell. Another key feature which is present in the plant cell wall is the plasmodesmata. This is a cytoplasmic channel which connects the cytoplasm of two adjacent cells. This channel helps in the transport of nutrients, stimuli, and several other materials. Next up is another mostly plant-specific organelle, chloroplast. Chloroplasts belong to a group of double membrane-bound organelles called plastids. They are surrounded by an outer membrane and an inner membrane. Apart from these two membranes, chloroplasts also contain another third membrane system, that is the thylakoid membrane. The coin-like structure here is referred to as thylakoid, and a stack of thylakoids is often referred to as granum. The thylakoid membrane is the region where many proteins and pigments that participate in the photochemical events of photosynthesis remain embedded. The grana are surrounded by an aqueous matrix, which is often referred to as stroma. The grana are also connected with each other by stromal lamellae. The chloroplast derives its name from its characteristic pigment chlorophyll. Plastids also contain a high concentration of carotenoids. They are called chromoplasts, and they are often responsible for the characteristic colors of orange, yellow of different fruits. The non-pigmented plastids are called leucoplasts. For example, amyloplast, that is a starch-storing plastid. So the main function of chloroplast is photosynthesis. So what does photosynthesis mean? The word photosynthesis literally means synthesis using light. Life on Earth thrives on the energy primarily derived from the sun. And photosynthesis is the only biological process that can harvest this solar energy. The photosynthetic organisms utilize the light energy and synthesize carbohydrates from carbon dioxide and water with the generation of oxygen. The reaction of photosynthesis can be summarized in the following equation, that is 6CO2 plus 6H2O in presence of chlorophyll and water produces C6H12O6, that is a carbohydrate, and 6 oxygen molecules. The most active tissue in the higher plants that participates in photosynthesis is the mesophyll of leaves, and they contain the chloroplasts, which in turn have chlorophylls. Photosynthesis involves numerous reactions that can be divided into two stages. The first one is the light stage or the thylakoid reactions. The second one, the dark stage or the carbon fixation reaction. The thylakoid reactions of photosynthesis take place in the specialized internal membranes of the chloroplast called the thylakoids. The series of reactions are initiated by the absorption of light energy by the chlorophylls and are used to drive a series of electron transfers, ultimately producing ATP or adenosine triphosphate and the electron donor reduced nicotine adenine dinucleotide phosphate or NADPH. During the dark stage, the ATP and NADPH formed in the light capturing reactions reduce carbon dioxide to organic carbon compounds, often sugars. This assimilation of inorganic carbon into organic compounds is called carbon fixation. So let's discuss about the different aspects of mitotic cell division in plant cell. Mitosis has been explained to you all in great detail by Professor Laloria in previous lectures. Here, I will give you a brief idea about certain key features that are unique to the plant mitotic cell division. So, mitosis is a process where the previously replicated chromosomes get aligned, separated, and distributed in an orderly fashion to the newborn daughter cells. And microtubules play an important role during the entire process. In case of plant cells, before the beginning of mitosis, the microtubules depolymerize. And before the beginning of prophase, they repolymerize to form a structure called pre-prophase band. This pre-prophase band is present around the nucleus and is often responsible for designating the position for the cell wall. The pre-prophase band is also thought to regulate the plane of cell division. The prophase is marked by the condensed chromosome, nucleolus disappearance, and also the appearance of prophase spindles. These spindles are assembled at two different foci present at the opposite pole of the cell. Plant cells do not contain centrosomes, but these two foci serve the same function. The pre-metaphase is marked by the disassembly of the pre-prophase band, the fragmentation of the nuclear envelope, and also the appearance of the mitotic spindles. The mitotic spindles are assembled at the diffused foci region of the opposite poles. They do not contain the centrosomes. So, in case of animal cells, because of the centrosome, the mitotic spindle assume an ellipsoidal structure. But in case of the plant cells, they assume more like a box structure. During the metaphase, the chromatids get aligned at the metaphase plate, and some of the mitotic spindles get attached to the kinetochore of the chromatids. These microtubules are called kinetochore microtubules. The free microtubules are referred to as polar microtubules. After metaphase comes the anaphase, where the chromatids are separated and pulled towards the pole, which is caused by the shortening of the kinetochore microtubules. This then leads to the telophase of the cell cycle. Telophase is marked by the cell plate growth, chromosome decondensation, and the nuclear envelope reappearance, which then lead to the cytokinesis of the cell, leading to the formation of two new daughter cells. Next comes another topic which needs to be discussed if we are talking about the plant system, that is the plant hormones or phytohormones. In plant system, the phytohormones are classified in different categories. The first one is the auxin kind. They promote stem elongation, inhibits growth of lateral buds. For example, indole acetic acid is an auxin class of hormone. Next comes the gibberellins. They promote stem elongation, and the classical example for gibberellin is gibberellic acid. Next comes the cytokinins. They promote cell division, example zeatin. Apart from these three classes, there are two more phytohormones. They are the abscisic acid, which promotes seed dormancy by inhibiting cell growth, and then comes the ethylene, which promotes ripening of fruit and crops. Now, depending on the mechanism of action of auxin hormone in the plant cell, a technique has been standardized to eliminate a protein of interest from an experimental model system. This technique is referred to as the auxin-inducible Degron system. A Degron is a short amino acid sequence or a structural motif or exposed amino acids that regulate the protein degradation. A Degron is a part of the protein itself. The function of an inducible Degron can be controlled externally by addition of the inducing compound. In this case, it is auxin. The inducible Degron systems are used to control the expression of a protein at various conditions. And the auxin inducible Degron system is easy to operate and has various advantages over the other inducible Degron system. For example, the N-end rule Degron. The several advantages of auxin-inducible Degron are, they can be tagged at both N and C terminal of the protein. This system is otherwise biologically silent and has no measurable physiological changes. The auxin-inducible Degron system can be applied in different eukaryotic model systems like yeast, mammals, mice, etc. But they cannot be applied in the plant system. Auxin is responsible for regulating certain gene expression in plant system that in turn is involved in the growth of the entire system. So let's understand the mechanism of action of auxin in the plant system. So plant system contain an E3 ubiquitin ligase called the SCF complex, where the FBOX protein is the transport inhibitor response 1 or the TIR1 protein. So, in the presence of auxin, this E3 ubiquitin ligase, that is the SCF-TIR1 complex, interact with the auxin repressor protein molecules, which basically represses the transcription of the certain genes. Once the interaction happens, this E3 ubiquitin ligase then recruit the E2 conjugating enzyme, leading to the polyubiquitination of the repressor protein, leading to its proteasomal degradation. In the auxin-inducible Degron system, a similar mechanism is followed. Here, we express the TIR1 gene in the genomic background of the model system. This TIR1 protein then uses the native SCF complex of the system. We also fuse the auxin-inducible degron tag with the target protein. Now, if we add auxin in the medium, that will lead to the interaction between this E3 ubiquitin ligase and our target protein, leading to the polyubiquitination of the protein and the proteasomal degradation. So, in this way, we can easily eliminate our protein of interest from the system to understand its function. So this brings us to the end of this short lecture, and so far we have learned the different parts of plant body, the plant cell and its organelles, the cell wall composition, chloroplast, different aspects of photosynthesis, mitosis, plant hormones, and ultimately the auxin-inducible degron or AID system. So that's all for today. Hope you all learned something new today, and all the best, and thank you.